our single machine in this lab, FSNUG. This is our file server that we stood up in a previous Nugget. Notice that we have four volumes here, a couple of NTFS volumes, a couple of REFS volumes. We're going to be working with the V drive. We configured this in a previous Nugget with the REFS file system and a 64K allocation unit size, which is perfect for storing our VHDs and VHDXs. Let's begin by learning how to create virtual hard disks in the GUI using the disk management utility. So give that start button a right click, head up there to disk management and launch it. There's a good look at all the drives we have on the system and the disks that power them. So what we're going to do first here is create a VHD, and we can do that graphically by dropping down the action menu here in the disk management utility and choosing to create a VHD. Let's go over our virtual hard disk formats. We have two of them, old school VHDs, new school VHDXs. VHDs have a really big limitation here, and that is their maximum disk size is 2 terabytes. So yeah, it's starting to show its age a little bit. The upside to VHDs, however, is that they're compatible with older operating systems. You can use them Server 2008 and up on the client side, Windows 7 and up. So about the only reason you'd use a VHD today is if you have to, right? If you have to support an older operating system, or on the Hyper-V side, if you need to support Generation 1 machines. Generation 1 VMs support both VHDs and VHDXs. Generation 2 machines only support VHDXs. So VHDXs, on the other hand, maximum disk size of 64 terabytes. They're also resilient to power failure events because they use metadata on the inside. Another one that Microsoft didn't list here is that they support 4K logical sector sizes, so they better align with today's modern disks. The only downside, however, is that they're only supported on the server side, 2012 and up, and on the client side, Windows 8 and up. Now, we're on server 2016. We have no need for a VHD, so let's go ahead and choose VHDX. We want access to all those sweet features. Now, notice something interesting with our hard disk type. When we choose VHD, it's going to recommend a fixed size. When we choose VHDX, it's going to recommend a dynamically expanding size. I'll talk about that in a second. But first, the differences between these is when we choose a fixed size, it's going to automatically allocate that space ahead of time. So if you were to create a 60 gigabyte disk, let's do that. 60 gigabytes. There we go. I'm sitting really weird, so that was actually really difficult to type 60. But anyway, if we were to specify a location, hit OK, it's going to allocate all that space ahead of time on disk. So you'll actually see that when you go and view your drive, 60 gigabytes will be missing from, in our case, our V drive here. We don't even have 60 gigabytes, so we couldn't even create a fixed disk of this size if we wanted to. Now, a dynamically expanding size, otherwise known as thin provisioning, just simply, we're just specifying the maximum file size that it can grow to here. It's going to start out with an incredibly small file, like 4K. It just contains some metadata inside of there, and that's it. And then as data is added to that disk, it's going to grow up to this maximum size. Now, the thinking has always been that fixed disks have always performed better than dynamically expanding or thinly provisioned disk, because all that space has already been allocated. There's no management overhead associated with it. But Microsoft has actually came out and stated that for VHDXs, there is no performance difference between fixed size and dynamically expanding. And this dialogue actually backs that up, because for VHDs, this is why it recommends fixed disks. For VHDXs, it's going to recommend dynamically expanding. All right, so let's get on with creating this disk here. Let's create a 1 terabyte dynamically expanding VHDX. All we need to do now is browse to where we're going to plant it. Let's go ahead and put this right on the disk that we created just for VHDs and VHDXs. There's a directory on the V drive here called disks. Let's go ahead and open this up, and let's just give this the name. How about data? Well, nice and creative there. Data. All right, we'll hit save. We'll hit OK, and it's done. Just like that, all done. Now, if we open up File Explorer here, go into the V drive, go into disks, check it out. There's our disk. Look at the size, 4K. It's tiny. There's nothing on it, so that'll grow all the way up to 1 terabyte in size. Now, because we created that in the GUI, it already attached it to our machine for us. In fact, if we scroll down here in disk management, look at that, it's attached. If we were to unattach this, you can just right click on it and choose detach and hit OK. Now it's gone. We could reattach it by dropping down the action menu, choosing attach VHD, and now we could browse right to it. So this is one of the nice things about these disks is, again, they're portable. So we could easily move these around from machine to machine and attach them. And once we attach them, if they're already formatted, no problem, it'll come up that way. But this is a brand new disk, so we need to format it. We can right click on it and initialize it first, bring it online, let's make this GPT. Cool, now we can right click and choose new simple value, hit next, next. Let's go ahead and format this with the D drive, hit next. We'll make this Let's call this one NTFS. That sounds good. We'll leave all the defaults here. Just hit next and finish. And there it is, ready to go. So now if we head into the file system here, up to this PC, look at that. We have a new D drive ready to go. And notice the size there, a terabyte. All right. So now we can come in here. We can create files. Here, let's create a file here. I'll create a big one. Let's right-click on the start button up to the command prompt. We're going to create a file using fsutil, nice old command line utility, to easily create a new file. Fsutil file create new, and let's just place this d colon whack. We'll call this, what do you want to call it? How about my file.txt? How big do we want it? How about really big? There we go. And it created it. Now, if we head back in here, there it is. We created a 200 megabyte text file. There's nothing in it. That's a great utility, by the way, just to create dummy files on the fly. So we did that. We've got a file in there. Now we can detach it. Let's go ahead and do that. Right click, choose detach VHDX. We'll hit OK. And that file is still safe. It's still inside of there, because if we were to head back into our V drive, into disks, look at this. Now it's no longer 4K. It's 324 megs. So that's how we can create, mount, and use virtual hard disks using our disk management graphical utility. Let's take a look at how to do this all using PowerShell. Let's head back to the file system, into this PC, into the C drive, where we have a Nugget Lab directory. Let's go ahead, right click, and launch our pscommands.ps1 script into the ISC. Now, all of the VHD related commandlets live in the Hyper-V PowerShell module. So we're gonna need to install that to get access to those commandlets. In fact, if we try to run a get command here, pass in the Hyper-V module and search for all the VHD commandlets in there, you'll see this is not gonna return anything because we haven't installed that yet. On your administrative workstations, you can just simply install the Hyper-V-PowerShell feature. In fact, just to show you here, if we run a get Windows feature and pass in, surrounded by wildcards, Hyper-V, we can actually see all of these roles and features here. There's the parent Hyper-V role, here's the management tools, and there is the module for PowerShell. So on your administrative workstations, just install Hyper-V-PowerShell, and you'll get access to all of those commandlets. Now, we're going to install all of Hyper-V here, because I've had mixed results here on the server side. If you just attempt to install the PowerShell commands, a lot of times they won't work. You need the Hyper-V infrastructure in place as well. So we're gonna go ahead and run an install Windows feature with the parent Hyper-V role and everything underneath it there with the include management tools. Once that's all set, we will require a reboot to start. So I'm gonna go ahead and run a restart computer. So that'll complete the installation of Hyper-V. Now we can head back into the file system here, back into the Nugget Lab directory, in the root of the C drive, and let's relaunch our script. Now let's run our get command, targeting the Hyper-V module and looking for commandlets specifically that contain the word VHD. Let's go ahead and run that selection and look at all the things we can do against our VHDs. We can create new ones. We can mount existing ones. We can dismount them. We can get the properties of them. We can even resize and optimize them. Again, we'll be looking at more of this stuff when we get into Hyper-V. So let's go ahead and head back here to the script pane. I'll just go split screen here. And now we can use the new VHD command to create a brand new VHD. All we need to do is specify the path. We'll call this one data2, plant it on the V drive here. Specify how big we want it. We can pass in dynamic or fixed, however we need, whatever we need this drive to be. This all looks good. Let's go ahead, put our cursor on that line and run that selection. And I'll just take a second. And now it's created. If we head back into the file system and into the V drive, into disks, look at that, there's data2. It's dynamic, so we get the standard 4K starting size here, and it'll grow up to 10 gigs. Next step is to mount it. That way, we can initialize it and format it before we can start using it. So mount VHD, very simple. Pass in the path to your newly created VHD. You can also mount this as read-only, just like we could in the GUI there. But we're good, we'll keep this writable so we can put some data on it. So let's go ahead and execute that line of code, and it'll mount it. And now we should be able to see it in disk management. So I'm gonna right click on the start button, head back up to disk management here. And we should see at the very bottom our disk. And it's probably gonna prompt us here to initialize it because it is an initialize. We will do that though using PowerShell. So hit cancel. And if we scroll down, there it is. Disk number 4, uninitialized, 10 gigabytes in size. So let's head back to PowerShell here and let's execute our one-liner, which will initialize it, partition it, and format it all in one shot. Awesome. And you can tell that worked because we got the little annoying message box letting us know that we should format it, even though we just did. So our D drive is now ready to go. It's been mounted, initialized, formatted, and we can see it back here reflected in disk management. There's that little blue icon just letting us know it's a virtual hard disk attached to the system. If we head back into File Explorer and head into the D drive, it's ready for data. So let's put some data on it. I have a fun little one-liner here that will generate 5,000 files and throw some random data inside of it. We'll actually expand on this. We built a fun script so we'll generate more realistic random files down the road. But for now, this is a great little one-liner. What it's going to do is create a loop from 1 to 5,000. So we're just going to pipe these numbers over and loop through them one at a time. So it's going to start at 1, then 2, all the way up to 5,000. So it'll end up running this block of code right here 5,000 times. And what it's going to do is take the current number that we're on. So when it's in the first loop, this dollar sign underscore will represent 1, in the next loop 2, 3, 4, so on and so forth, and multiply it by this line of code right here, which is going to generate a random number between 1 and 100. You can actually highlight this little block here and hit execute, and it's going to give us a random number between 1 and 100 every single time I hit execute. So it's going to multiply the current iteration that we're on by that value and just stuff that inside of the file. We'll also use the current number that we're in, loop iteration that we're in, and use that as a file name. So we'll end up making 5,000 files with a random value inside of it. Kind of fun, but let's execute this, and it'll just take a second to create those files. You can actually head right back into it and see, watch it create them. See that I'm at 391, when this update 582, it's just gonna keep going. It'll take a little bit to hit 5,000. That's gonna generate a lot of files. And if you open up any one of these, you'll see that random number, and it'll slowly start to go up as you go down through your files. So just a fun little thing to do, I suppose. No real purpose in doing that, but we added data to our virtual hard disk. Once that is done, we can then dismount it. All right, it finally finished for me. It didn't take that long, probably about a minute, but the end result is 5,000 files full of fun. So now we could dismount this. Very simple. Dismount VHD, pass in your path, and now it's gone. If we head back into File Explorer here, by the way, and take a look at that, let's see how big it got. There it is. There's data two. Not too bad. 160 megs for 5,000 1 kilobyte files. But we can also get information here by running a get VHD, pass in the path to your disk. You'll get all kinds of good information here, such as our format, our type, our size, sector sizes, both logical and physical, and some other.